playoffs, and that was our ultimate. Didn't attain that until 3 weeks until the end of the season, and then we were still in position to win the WCHA, but you know, that wasn't even solved until the last weekend when Minnesota won two games against Wisconsin. We lost two games against Denver and allowed them to be co-champions with us, but the week before we beat Michigan Tech twice at home, and our fans were able to see us parade around Engelstad Arena with the McNaughton Trophy, and that certainly was a real important moment for not only our seniors, but our entire team, our entire community, and fans to see, you know, the result of a lot of hard work and entertaining hockey.
So at what point in the season did you allow yourself to think, you know, maybe this team could win a national title?
Never. Never until maybe Michigan got beat out by Boston University, because I didn't even think against if Michigan were had beaten Boston University, then, you know, then you're worried right up until game time. But, you know, I really thought when Boston beat Michigan that we'd have a real good chance, or at least a 50% chance of beating Boston University. And that's the only time during the year that I ever think and ever imagine that we'd have a chance, because Michigan won it last year and all their players stayed, and I'm sure a lot of them have signed pro contracts as we speak now.
Well, we won't be talking about it much longer. When we come back, we'll show you the highlights of the NCAA semifinals and championship game. Stay with us.
The education that you get is as good as or better than what you can get at anywhere else.
The teachers really go out of their way to help you outside of class.
It's just an incredibly rich opportunity and environment here.
Dean Blaze. Dean, before we get to the highlights, one of the key guys on your team this year obviously was freshman goalie Aaron Schweitzer. Came out of nowhere and basically carried this team down the stretch. How surprised are you that he wound up being the guy carrying the load?
Well, real surprise, especially when he didn't play a game up until the Duluth series before he went home for Christmas, and we won 8-4, and he was a little bit shaky in that game, but we scored 8 goals, and then we put him in when he got back from Christmas vacation, and he beat Boston University 6-4. And from that point on, he gained confidence and matured a little bit as a goaltender. And then I think the real turning point for Aaron was when we went out to Colorado College, and we beat him 3-0, and that was his first shutout, and a few more to follow afterwards. But he had 36 saves in that game, and he was the difference in the game. He won that game. Like a few goaltenders won games against us, Aaron won for us in that game.
Kid just turned 18 in December, and what amazes me is nothing rattles this guy. I mean, he's one of the calmest people I've ever met.
Well, Aaron concentrates like no other goaltender I've seen in quite a while. He squares up to the puck wherever it's at in the rink, and that's really unusual for a goaltender to have that concentration. Even when we're in the offensive zone, he's out on his angles, and he tries to line up. If the puck's on the left side, he'll be on the left side. If it's over on the right, he'll make the adjustment and slide. So that's really unusual because we don't give up a lot of shots. Some of the shutouts that he had, he only had to stop 12, 13 shots. But that's even tougher at times because there's a breakdown. There might be a two-on-one or a breakaway, and he's always risen to the occasion. I think he ended up the season at 17-3 with over a 90% save percentage.
Unbelievable. Aaron and the team played well in front of them, too. Let's take a look at Thursday afternoon's NCAA semifinal with Colorado College. You said in the pregame that you knew it was going to be UND's
game. Well, here's just a great goal by Matt Henderson getting the puck out to Adam Caller. Matt is a mucker, a grinder down low, and Adam Caller, we talked about yelling for the puck and communicating for it, and here just a typical example of taking some time and shelfing it right over his glove, and an excellent shot, but he had to yell for that puck. And here is a good example of just going to the net. Kevin Hoogsteen driving to the net when Jesse Bull was going in, and another goal just through hard work.
Here's one 33 seconds later as Ian Calais pressures a turnover and Jason Blake just knocks it down.
Just pure high hand-eye coordination, and again, Jason Blake has a real knack for putting the puck in the net, and he could have deked, and or shot, but he chose to shoot there, and he had something to shoot at. But there you just saw a big save by Aaron Schweitzer, and the puck ended up in the corner. And when he's on, that's where most of the pucks are end up going to be. Oh, here's a great goal by Matt Henderson, driving in the net. There was a delayed penalty on this, and Matt was thinking to pass the puck, but he didn't really have good possession of it. It was kind of flipping up and down, and their guy kind of knocked it into the net. Again, example of communicating, and we do a lot of shooting off passes, and here's David Hoogsteen banging in a pass off Ian Collet.
Now here's a break for the Sioux as Brad Williamson thwarts a two-on-one.
And right, he got down. And did you notice that when that guy got the shot off there, we had three guys back? And, you know, at times, big hit by Mark Pivots right there. At times we make mistakes, but at other times we got guys coming back and support. And here's a good goal by Jesse Bull. He's thinking pass, but the defenseman slides down in front of the puck, and all he had was a five-hole, and that's where he put it. And yep. Jesse's just had a great year, from one goal last year to 16 this year.
6-2 after two, and then Aaron Schweitzer does the rest.
Another big save there by Aaron.
And you guys held Brian Swanson without a goal. That was one of your big priorities, too.
Yes, it was. And the Matt Henderson line with Adam Call and Jeff Fulmer was assigned to that line. And I think through two periods, we were charting Brian, and he only had two shots on net. And I don't think he had a quality shot. But Colorado maybe had a little bit tougher playoff than we did. They had to go almost an extra game with Wisconsin to get by. Then they had to travel out east and had an emotional win over Clarkson, the number one seed out there. And I think a big goal of theirs was to get back to the Final Four. But I think when they got there, they were a little bit tired from all the emotion that they had to spend. And we didn't really have to spend that much. I mean, we played Cornell, but it was a 6-2 win for us.
Well, then BU winds up stunning Michigan on Thursday night, so it's Boston U and North Dakota, and you thought BU was definitely a better matchup for your team.
Well, just because Michigan's talent level, and, you know, they only lost three games all year, four with the game against Boston University, but, you know, everyone was picking them to win the championship. They said at the banquet that they were, I guess, thankful for their alumni, thankful for their players that come back to try to win their second national title in a row, something that hadn't been done very often in the history of the NCAA tournament.
Let's take a look at how it transpired Saturday afternoon at the Bradley Center. Beautiful building in downtown Milwaukee. Dean facing Jack Parker for the third time this season. And BU opens the scoring on a rebound goal by Peter Donatelli.
Yeah, it's one of the few times where that puck should have been in the corner. And Aaron had his angle, but our defenseman could have been there and tied up Donatelli. Donatelli is one of those players that's always around the net, and give him credit for getting there.
You guys had your chances.
Jason Blake backhand right out of the rink, and you can see the expression on his face was one of frustration, and he couldn't believe that he missed that, but he certainly, you know, here's another great save by their goaltender. Matt Henderson had the wide open net there for a second. I don't even think he knew where this puck was, other than being square to it. It could have went in on the far side or between his legs. Here's a great pass, Chris Drury on the power play. Aaron Schweitzer didn't move over, but he squared up to that defenseman on the point, and that was just a good play on their power play.
And the misery, I guess, continues early in the second. Michel Larocque, another save on David Hoogsteen, and seconds later, Armbrust deflects off the post.
Yep, and there's a good example. We had two guys right out in front of the net. Here's a goal that goes in by Curtis Murphy. We had guys out in front of the net, and he just put it on net. Panzer was screening him a little bit, and Curtis got the shot off quick.
And that's the one that leads to four more.
And I couldn't believe that David Hoogsteen got this puck, but, you know, he's in the right place at the right time, and shelves it again. Their goaltender went back a little bit, and David had that corner, but give him credit for picking the toughest place to score on a goaltender is over his glove, and David put it away. Here, Matt Henderson read this play. He kind of fakes a shot right here and goes to his forehand. An excellent move, because he didn't have a lot of time because of both defensemen chasing him down.
BU does get a power play goal later after Schweitzer made the first save. Chris Kelleher saves it at the line, floats it in.
Yeah, and he couldn't get up for some reason. He almost snagged that on his backhand, but he was down, and that's kind of unusual that Aaron was down like that. But here's another example of Matt Henderson in front, yelling, screaming for the pass like he always does. And you can almost throw a blind pass out there the way he yells. two guys go down the block at 5 seconds left to go in the period, and you can see David Hoogsteen's emotion. Jason Blake almost drives him through the glass. But a huge goal for us to go up 5-3, and that was five goals for us in the second period. Here's an open net goal. We knew that when Adam called, he was thinking about passing right here, but thank goodness he shot it into the net, because we go up 6-4, and basically that was a championship. We knew that they weren't going to score with only 20-some seconds left, and there's a celebration, what it's all about, and the emotion. Jackie Park is a class guy, and he said, you know, Michigan had the most talent, and maybe they had a great year, but we were the best team in the nation, and we deserved it. So we'll take that compliment from Jackie Parker, a real class guy.
Well, it was a long road, Dean, and we've heard from you, and now we want to hear from some of your players. Let's take in the sights and sounds of the post-game celebration.
This is my first year at University of North Dakota playing hockey. And it's just a dream come true watching the 1987 team to win. They won the championship, and I promised Coach honestly that he would get a national championship by the time I left. And, you know, this is for him right now.
That's it, boys.
Is this any sweeter for you just being from Grand Forks?
I think it might be, you know. Having grown up there and watching the Sioux pretty much my whole life, you know, it's a great plus for this team, for the community, and for our school. I think it's just unreal.
Oh, it's unbelievable. Who would have ever thought at the beginning of the year, you know, winning 11 games as a freshman, as a senior going out as a champion. It's just unbelievable for the whole team, and it's nice to see us do so well. We don't have the most talented players in the nation, but you know what? We have the lot most heart and determination, and we all come together as a great team, great bunch of guys, and we want it.
Oh, it's the greatest feeling in the world right now, you know. And I think it'll be greater later once we realize what we've actually done, but it's tremendous. Guys played great all year, and this is a reward.
I think the whole first period, I don't know about these other guys, but I was just nervous as all hell. I couldn't handle the puck. I couldn't do anything. I was just so nervous, just maybe not so nervous, but anxious and excited.
Could you tell me what went through your mind when you put that empty netter in to lock up a national championship?
I was so nervous. I knew that it was a 2-on-1, and carrying it down the ice, I could feel my hands just shake, and I just wanted to put it on net. I thought about passing it to, I thought it was Jeff at the, when he was coming with him, but I ended up seeing Ian, and I didn't want to pass and screw it up, so I just tried to put it in the middle of the net.
It's kind of sad I'll never put on the North Dakota jersey anymore, but if I wanted to go out, this is the way I wanted it to be.
I just said I'm not going to leave any stones unturned. I'm here. I may never be here again or in a position like this again in my life. I said I'm going to take advantage of it. And luckily, I got the bounces.
I'm kind of like a vegetable right now. I really can't take it all in at once. There's so much going on. We just won the national championship. Last week we advanced from Grand Rapids, won the final five in our regular season title. So it's just starting to set in that we won the regular season now. So I got a couple weeks ahead of me for this one.
Now, Dean, there's the guy, Toby Kovalevog, in a tough spot there down the stretch. Most guys would have trouble handling that. He wasn't playing, Schweitzer was, but he was a team guy all the way.
Yes, he's the epitome of a team man and the ultimate unselfish player. And, you know, lost his job basically midway through the season, but he was one of the reasons and might be the biggest reason why we were in position to win the championship. He played most of the games at the first half of the year, and played more hockey here at North Dakota than any other goaltender has. And for him to be more of a coach the last half of the year than a player, just a total, I guess, credit to his parents, his family, and himself as a player and a real team man, because he'd go out on the ice with Aaron Schweitzer and help him out, and never made Aaron feel like he was taking his job. And you can just give Toby all the credit in the world for doing that. And probably the biggest reason we won, other than Aaron being in the net, is Toby supporting him.
Did Jason Blake really promise you a title?
Well, he said before he left here, you know, we talked about Jason staying. He gets a little bit worried about being too old and running out of eligibility and time and everything. But, you know, he sat out all of last year. And for him to win a national championship, and he wanted to be an All-American and get his picture up there on the in the lobby with everyone else that was an All-American here. And he was first team All-WCHA along with David Hooksey and Curtis Murphy. And, you know, he said that he wanted to win a national championship before he left. We didn't think it would be this early, so I don't know if he's going to leave or not, but we'd like to see him stay for at least another year to get, you know, stronger and more mature in his game and everything he does.
Well, we've heard from Sioux players present. We want to hear from some of the Sioux players past.
I think it was a misnomer to describe that team as overachievers. I heard it from several coaches this year. I watched this team this year. They get the best team in the country when they play their game. There's not a team that could beat them. Bring on Michigan.
We're so close to the players because, you know, we spent the last 3 years, and you can just imagine how they're feeling. It's just, you know, you still feel kind of a part of the whole Sioux thing, and it's just fun to be here and have the Sioux win. It's unbelievable.
You brought in some of the old-timers to talk to the team before Saturday's game, didn't you?
Well, Tim O'Keefe, Reggie Morelli, Gary Severson, Mike Curran, and Dennis Hextall in there, along with Ralph Engelstad and Reggie Morelli. I made a repeat of those names, but, you know, it's really neat to see our alumni back. And they didn't have a lot to say. Phil Sykes was there and was a member of the 50-year team, and he walked out on the ice with his North Dakota jersey on, and everyone there certainly was proud of Phil. And Tony Herkes was on that team also, but he wasn't there. And how proud we were of those guys. And then when they walked in the dressing room, it just kind of, it settled the guys down a little bit and showed a lot of support on, I guess, our alumni's behalf.
Dean, final question. How are you going to remember this 1996-97 team?
I guess I remember, you know, a lot of things during the year and a lot of different ways our team played the game and a lot of ways that we won games when the other team tried to hold us back, interfere, intimidate us, and it never bothered the guys. And I think that was the difference from this year's team to last year's team. Last year's team, we only won 25% of our games on the road. This year, we were, I believe, 16-2-2 at home, real effective at home. And I believe on the road, we were something like 15-8, and we had 31 wins. So not only the wins, but just the character of these players and how proud we are as coaches to be associated with a young team like this that wasn't supposed to win.
What a year. And Dean, thank you for being with us tonight. Congratulations.
Thanks,
again. All right, back with more right after this.
Welcome back to A Night of Champions. I'm Rob Vogel, and that was the scene at the Hislop Sports Center just a couple of weeks ago as the Sioux women win their first ever Division II national championship, defeating the University of Southern Indiana in the championship game. And joining me now is Sioux women's head coach Gene Roebuck. Congratulations, coach. It's been a little while now. You've had a chance to celebrate this. Has it finally started to sink in that you've captured your first ever national championship?
Well, it's definitely sunk in. It's just a great feeling. It's a great feeling on campus. You know, for myself and especially my team, our team, you know, to be able to achieve something that they've had to work so hard for. And it's just a great feeling. And it's pretty much a championship for not only us, but for the University of North Dakota and the community of Grand Forks, too.
Let's go back to the beginning of the season and going into the year and your expectations. You talked about that your goal really for the past few years, every year going in, has been winning a national championship. That's a high goal, one which you reached. But what were your expectations realistically at the start of the season for this team?
Well, really going back a number of years, you know, we've won conference championships. We won regional championships. So really the only thing left was a national championship, and we've been knocking at the door and very close for a number of years. And you know, achieving it was great, and going into this season, that was our goal. And that's our goal every year, and that'll be our goal again next year. I felt that this team is very athletic, but they're very young, mm-hmm. and we would have to mature during the course of the season. And when you got young players, freshman players like Jamie Pudenz and Katie Richards, you really don't know what to expect because they haven't been through the conference yet. And I really thought they matured during the course of the season. Jamie was good throughout the year, and Katie Richards really came on at the end. But, you know, our upperclassmen really did a great job of leading us. I felt Kelly Britz and Allison Dirk were super leaders for our team, and I really felt that Tiffany Pudenz really turned the corner and became a great player in the conference. And a lot of little things happened, but the players that were here the year before really stepped their game up to the next level, and the young players coming in were good.
As you went through this season, it wasn't a season that ended in a conference title, but there was, as you mentioned, some growing pains that the team went through and a maturing process for some of the younger players, as you mentioned. Was there a turning point or a major learning point for the team this season where they maybe got that confidence that helped them later on to get through over the hump in the playoffs?
Well, we lost some games in the second half where we were ahead, and not just ahead by a few points. You know, we were ahead by 9 points at North Dakota State in December, and we're ahead by 14 points in the second half in Grand Forks against North Dakota State in February. And then we lost a tough game out in Northern Colorado where I think we're ahead by 19 points. And I think if you learn from that, you become a better team. And I think our players didn't get depressed or get down from it. I think they came back the next week and worked very hard. And I think that's a maturing process. And you know, we had to come from behind in the regional tournament in two games in the second half, and we did that. And I think maybe those losses might have helped us mature a little bit better.
The memorable stretch run for the Sioux women as they took on North Dakota State in the championship game of the North Central Regional game. Tough to describe and put into words, so we bring it to you through the sights and sounds of the players' eyes.
About it. We got to keep our cool, just keep executing the plays, do the little things, you know, and don't get so uptight and keep attacking. I wanted her to have the ball because she had confidence in her shot and really made it come in hell. It was justice she missed it, and so I guess it's justice now she made it. I've seen those girls lose some tough, hard ones, and you know, I don't want to see Allison and Kelly go all up like that. I want to, you know, keep moving on, and hopefully we'll get to that championship.
Well, Coach, that game was very indicative of the way your team played the whole postseason. You got performances, great performances, from a lot of different players.
Well, in that basketball game down the stretch, I counted six people that scored in the last 6 minutes, and you know, Kelly Britz hit some big threes. Tiffany Pudenz hit a big two. Jamie Pudenz made free throws. Allison Dirk made free throws. And Katie Richards and Jenny Krause got some real big offensive rebounds. So if you're going to beat a great team like North Dakota State, you got to have everybody contributing and everybody stepping up when you need it. And at times during the course of the year in our losses, we try to do a lot of things individual. And I think this game, we really went out and played as a team down the stretch and relied on each other.
Well, then you move on to the Elite Eight. The Sioux would get to host the Elite Eight in Grand Forks. And You had Edinburgh and Bentley in your first two games. Were you worried at all about a letdown? Because it didn't seem like the team had one. You had two fairly comfortable wins in your quarterfinals and semifinal games.
Well, I think the biggest thing is not to worry about a letdown. I think we had to prepare ourselves for what we do and not worry about Edinburgh or Bentley. Bentley, of course, would be the second game, so we had to worry about Edinburgh. But we took one game at a time, and I really felt that Edinburgh winning their region was going to be a very good basketball team. So we didn't know what to expect. We just had to go out and play.
A special feeling for not only for yourself, but for the team and for the fans in your Grand Forks that everybody got to share in this one, the fact that you got to play it on your home court in front of your home fans. How special was that for you and for the team? I know it was obviously a help having the crowd supporting you instead of against you, but how special was it to be able to share in this with the crowd?
Well, even more special than, you know, having the crowd support us and get us pumped up, I think this was for the crowd. Mm-hmm. Being the fans that we've had since I've been here have gotten better every year, and they're true loyal fans. They come whether you win or lose. So this was really, I think, an icing on the cake for the fans, too, because they got to see a great tournament, and we're in it, and they earned it, too.
And again, as you mentioned when we talked about the North Dakota State game, that lots of players contributing. We see Kelly Britz there. We see players coming off the bench. You got great support from everybody on your team.
Well, it's a bunch of little things that turn out to be the big thing, and it was different players stepping up in different games and getting contributions from our bench. I think our bench played really big in the regionals and also in the national tournament. I thought they really played big in the Elite Eight. So I think it was a total team effort.
So the Sioux move on to the championship game where the University of Southern Indiana awaited, and this was going to be a bit of a departure in games and style of play from your first two games, a very up-tempo game. But I think you said that this was a game, though, that you were looking forward to because you felt this style really favored your team. You enjoyed this.
Well, first of all, I thought the Bentley game, they slowed the game down, and I think when you slow the game down, we become too patterned. We start to do things too mechanical, and our players play the best when they run the floor and they play up-tempo, and I was kind of happy that Southern Indiana beat UC Davis because UC Davis had a half-court zone trap, and that's something you don't see, and Southern Indiana is going to force us to go, and they were going to force us to go 100% full court. And I think when that happened, they were pretty much playing in our hands, and we weren't playing in their hands. And I think that's what happened. Our players really ran the floor well and played with their instincts. And when that happens, I think you got a great basketball team.
I know there's been big games in that building before, and I guess you'd expect it for a championship game, but really a special electricity in the building that afternoon for this game.
Well, I remember the first day that I stepped on the UND floor back 10 years ago. I had that feeling of you know, the Dave Gunther was here, Bill Fitch was here, and it was just a special feeling being from North Dakota and being able to represent the University of North Dakota. And when I stepped on that floor for the Elite Eight Championship, I mean, that was truly, truly the most special feeling I've had at UND, just to see the fans there to watch us play, the women's basketball team, and really the fans, you just feel that electricity in the air. And it was kind of like a little theater with all the new lights and stuff like that they put in. So this was a game that as far as I'm concerned, will go with me forever.
I know that there's a lot of waves of emotion that come over you as the clock's winding down in those final moments. And thinking back to all of those players that put into this program that led up to that moment, it was really a win for the entire program, I would think.
Well, we had a pep rally the morning of the game, and Sherry Kleinsaucer and Tracy Pudence were there, and as on the way out, I did walk up to them and say, this game's for you, because they're the ones that kept this this dream, so to speak, going. Them and a lot of other players that have come so close, and they're the ones that have kept us at the top, and the players that are here right now, I think, achieved that goal. But the players that were there before are the ones that kept it going. So I really have a lot of respect for all the players that have played for me at UND.
Well, after the game, the players that were on the court and won that first ever national championship for the Sioux women's basketball program spoke about what it meant to finally win the big one.
You know, it's just such a great moment for me. You know, I never won a state championship or anything like that. So this is unbelievable. You know, we had such great fan support today. I think the whole community was practically here. The crowd, the band, everybody, you know. I'm just so excited.
I don't think it's really sunk in yet. It's great as a senior to walk off that court in front of all those great fans and to be a national champion, to win your last game as a senior, and I love it.
I guess I've thought of all this thousands of times, just winning a championship, because I've never done that before, and you know, I just watch the fans, and they enjoy it too. I watch my sister choose ball in the 2 minutes to go with Tracy was, so I guess we kind of did it for ourselves, and we did it for, you know, the old players.
I've been around the program a long time, and I've seen him almost win, you know, almost get there. And me and Tracy have talked, you know, a long time about, you know, we can do it. And, you know, she's like, it's over for me, but I know you can do it. She's always believing in us. So I think it was a team win, and also to be on the court with Tiffany and win a national championship, it couldn't be much better.
Well, Coach, you mentioned each season being a journey, and this has been a long journey for you to get to that national championship. Has it been what you expected it would be? Obviously, you put a lot of build-up and hype on something like that, a goal that you're always striving for. Now that you've won it and had a chance to savor for a little bit, is it everything you'd expected it to be?
Well, it definitely is. I mean, it just keeps going on and on, and at some point, we're going to have to put it behind us and start looking towards next year, but we're not going to do that quite yet.
Next year will come next year, and for right now, the Sioux basketball team will savor that national championship, their first ever on the Division II level. Much more when we return on this Night of Champions. Stay with us. Of champions, after the amazing Saturday-to-Saturday stretch that saw two Sioux teams win national championships, Sioux fans and the city of Grand Forks threw the teams one last victory celebration. On Tuesday night at Ingolstadt Arena, UND hosted what it called a winter sports spectacular, a night filled with ovations, congratulatory letters, and messages from Sioux fans around the country, including Governor Ed Schaefer. In all, about 3,000 people turned out for what proved to be one final piece of the Sioux's championship puzzle.
Not every day you win a national championship, so I thought I'd make the fans a memory somehow. Welcome to the University of North Dakota, the home of champions! All right!
I'm so happy for this team, and not only this team, but all the players that played for me at UND that have worked so hard, and every year they might not have achieved a national championship, but they picked themselves up, and they went back to work, and they kept the standard of UND women's basketball at such a high level, and this team did it.
Thank you very much. So what do you think of this tie?
It's 75 miles down to the south of us. Take a good look at this hardware and eat your hearts out.
Unbelievable. It's been great all year. You know, I knew they'd be out tonight in swarms, and they've been great all year, and I think that's why we are the national champions, because of them. Oh, it really hasn't sunk in too much, though. Like I said, maybe a half an hour here, half an hour there, but hopefully someday when I'm looking back, it'll sink in.
Typical of this UND community and stuff. I mean, look at them all, what great support we have, and I'm just fortunate to be here. I think this was the crowning moment. I guess it really hasn't sunk in until I walked out here and, you know, seen the trophies all sitting there, so what an amazing accomplishment.
It was a special night for all those in attendance, player and fan alike, and it's certainly a year that no one will soon forget. When we return on Night of Champions, we'll see and hear the impact these two national titles has had on some familiar North Dakota names. Back with that and much more when we return.
the university, but for the city of Grand Forks and the state of North Dakota, as we hear from some UND administrators and a few of North Dakota's elected officials.
Obviously, the most important thing that it does is to sort of reinforce in everybody's mind the enormous pride and quality that we have in the institution. It really serves to remind us all of what this institution is all about. It generates spirit and it generates focus and all of those wonderful things. And that's really what makes this university a great university. We have tremendous pride in the institution and in the quality of the people who are part of it, whether they're athletes, whether they're students, whether they're alums or whatever. And this kind of an event just tends to epitomize that and cement all of those things, and it's wonderful. It also, of course, provides wonderful publicity for the state of North Dakota and for the university. I mean, gosh, I mean, we've had stories in all of the national newspapers and all the national networks. Hey, that's not too bad.
Certainly from the university and the community, from a state or region, here are national alumni. It's a great rallying point and something that you hope to build on for the future to maintain that connection with all of the people that have a great interest in University of North Dakota Athletic Department. So it's been a lot of fun. I got a lot of email, a lot of cards. I know Coach Blaze and Coach Roebuck have as well. So it's just been a lot of fun.
Successes like this can do more for us than any amount of advertising or whatever. It just brings people here and it lifts the spirit and it makes people real positive about our community.
I couldn't get ESPN in Washington. I went down to a local bar. We're sitting at the end of the bar by myself, yelling and hollering, and this guy finally turns over. It's the end of the third period. We're about to win the national championship. He says, "How many people live in North Dakota?" I said, 650,000, and we love hockey. And he said, "Awesome, awesome." I'm a Fighting Sioux alum, and I'm telling you, it was a mighty proud afternoon in that bar stool in Washington, D.C. I thought the team played great, and I'm very, very proud of the effort they put forward. And then the women's title was also really, really wonderful. It's a real jewel in the crown when you win a national title. Year in and year out, we've got good programs, but to bring both these titles home this year is just wonderful. The Washington Post has covered the hockey win in particular, the New York Times, and it does it. It underscores that we can compete with anybody, and our teams did just that.
What does it mean for the state?
Well, I think, you know, it's nice when North Dakota's in the news about something other than snow disasters or flood disasters, and our athletes made sure we got in there for some national championships as well.
I'm a UND graduate. I'm a big Sioux booster and a Sioux fan. When the Sioux hockey team wins another national championship, I just bust my buttons with pride. When the Sioux women's basketball team wins a championship, national championship, you know, I just smile ear to ear because it's wonderful to see that North Dakota goes out and wins national championships, and they do it with North Dakota talent. I mean, you don't have to come from a big town to have a big heart and big talent. And, you know, all across the state, people from North Dakota high schools come filtering into our system, come to our colleges, and then go out and win national championships. It's really quite a remarkable achievement.
One of the things we've found, for example, in recruiting businesses, if we can convince them to come here, we can sell them on moving operations here. That has been the biggest hurdle that we face, getting them to come out here and take a look. And when they do that, we're able to convince them. And this kind of exposure and this kind of attention helps us sell the story of North Dakota. I think the message that has most captivated people's attention is that these are underdog teams and teams that show it, hey, if you've got the spirit, you can do it. That's the great message.
Well said. There's more to come. Up next, our musical tribute to UND's sixth National Hockey Championship and first Women's Basketball Championship. Us to remember a pair of championship seasons.
We leave you tonight with a musical salute to the national hockey and women's basketball champions. Good night.
Good night.
Yeah, that tells you, I mean, how strong our team is and how well we work together.
Players, take your places. There's only one way to the top. Feel that victory, release that energy. And ride like the wind. With fire in your eyes, shake the butterflies. Yeah. Victory, victory.
just a great feeling, especially since I'm a senior.
I want to, you know, keep moving on and hopefully we'll get to that championship.
We picked to finish fifth in the league, last by one coach in the WCHA, and to be here is just, I can't explain it.
Talented players in the nation, but you know what, we have the lot most heart and determination, and we all come together as a great team, great bunch of guys, and we want it. It's just great. This is the best year I've had here, and you know, I'll remember it always.
It's a dream come true for him. You know, it's one of those things you dream about, you never sometimes succeed, but this came true.
What I ever thought, beginning of the year, you know, winning 11 games as a freshman, as a senior going out as a champion, it's just unbelievable.
Champion.